This is a quick tutorial to remind us how to determine if a molecule is polar or nonpolar. So let's start with the example BH3. The first thing that we're going to do is, first step, sketch it out. So remembering how to sketch, we want to put our central atom in the middle, and we want to disperse the other elements around at 12, 3, 6, and 9. In this case, we only have 3, so we spread them out this way. We want to then distribute any remaining electrons. So if we recall from previous chemistry courses, we want to take a look at how many valence electrons each of those elements possesses. So if we take a look at boron, boron is in the third group, therefore it has 3 valence electrons. So in total, we have 3 valence electrons, and each hydrogen has 3 valence electrons. So that gives us 6 valence electrons total. We know that we have to have a covalent bond between them, so we draw our covalent bonds. Each covalent bond accounts for 2 of those 6. So we have 6 bonded electrons, which means we have 0 electrons that are non-bounded or free electrons. So that would be our sketch. The second thing we want to do is determine, are there any polar bonds? So we take a look at the electronegativity, and the electronegativity for boron is 2.0, and the electronegativity for hydrogen is 2.1. So each hydrogen has a 2.1, which means our change in electronegativity, or our difference in electronegativity, the difference between 2 and 2.1 is 0.1. So that value alone tells us that no, there are not any polar bonds. And if there are no polar bonds, then there cannot be a polar molecule. So this is a non-polar molecule. Let's take a look at a second example of practicing determining whether a molecule is polar or non-polar. So let's take a look at NH3. So the first step we always want to do is sketch it out. So we put our central atom is going to be the nitrogen. We're going to distribute the hydrogens around it. And then we have to decide if there are any unbound electrons. So we take a look at valence electrons. Nitrogen has 5 valence electrons. Each hydrogen has 1 valence electron. So we have 8 valence electrons total. We add our covalent bonds in. Each covalent bond accounts for 2. So we have 6 bonded electrons. That leaves us with 2 free electrons left. Now, each hydrogen has a full valence shell by using the sharing of the electrons to the nitrogen. Nitrogen only has access to 2, 4, 6, so the unbounded ones are going to then go on nitrogen. So step one is sketching it out. Step two is determining, are there any polar bonds? So if we take a look, the electronegativity for nitrogen is 3.0. The electronegativity for each hydrogen is 2.1. So our change or difference in electronegativity is 3 minus 2.1 is 0.9. That falls within our range for a polar covalent bond. So we know, yes, we do have polar bonds. Each of these bonds has a negativity that is pulling towards the nitrogen. So the third step to determine, we know we have polar bonds, do we have a polar molecule, is we have to look at symmetry. Are these bonds pulling in such a way that they're canceling each other out? So if we look at these bonds, all of these electronegativities or polar bonds are pulling towards this nitrogen. So this bond and this bond would not cancel each other out. There is a net negativity around this nitrogen, and this one's pulling in as well. So we can say that symmetry or the pull of those bonds will not cancel each other out. So we know that we have a polar molecule. Let's do a third example, taking a look at carbon dioxide and whether it is a polar or a non-polar molecule. So step one is always to sketch it out. So we put carbon as our central atom, we put the oxygens on either side. Now we need to determine how many covalent bonds. So we take a look at how many valence electrons. Each carbon has 4 valence electrons, so that's 4. Each oxygen has 6, so that's another 12 valence electrons. That gives us 16 valence electrons. If we were to put 1 covalent between them, that would only account for 4 of the valence electrons, which means we would have to disperse 12 around, and we would not be able to fulfill the octet rule for all of them. So we would add in 2 more bonds, so we now account for 2, 4, 6, 8 bonded electrons. That gives us 8 free electrons left. Carbon has access to 2, 4, 6, 8. It doesn't need any more. Each oxygen needs four more, so lucky enough, we can put four on each oxygen. So there's our sketch. Number two is we determine, are there any polar bonds? So we have to take a look at the electronegativity. Electronegativity value for carbon is 2.5. Electronegativity for oxygen is 3.5 on either side. So if we look at this, our change or a difference in electronegativity is a value of 1.0. This means that yes, we do have a polar bond. Each of these bonds is a polar bond, with the electrons spending more time with the oxygen than they do with the carbon. So then we take a look at symmetry. So if we look at the symmetry, each oxygen is pulling those electrons with the exact same force in absolute opposite direction. So if you were to imagine as a tug of war, this pull towards this oxygen would cancel out the pull towards this oxygen. So we can say that the symmetry of the pulling, or the opposite forces of those pulling, would actually cancel out. So yes, we have symmetry. So even though we have polar bonds, we have a non-polar molecule.